Late this afternoon, a state Supreme Court judge found the TWU Local 100 guilty of contempt of court for choosing to strike in spite of the state's Taylor law prohibiting a walkout by public employees. He also imposed large fines. We have team coverage tonight. We'll begin with Tim Minton outside state Supreme Court in downtown Brooklyn. Tim?
David, the issues here for Judge Theodore Jones were, number one, was there an order barring a strike? Number two, did the union issue a strike direction to its members? Number three, was there in fact a strike? He found on all three in favor of the state and the MTA and against the union, and dealt what even unions, the union's own attorney late today said could be a crushing blow. Just 12 hours after negotiations fell apart, both sides faced off in court. The MTA and Attorney General's office stating what seemed obvious to New Yorkers today: there's a transit strike. Union attorneys responding they weren't so sure.
We do know that the system is closed down in large measure. I'm not personally aware of the extent of the closure, whether everything is closed or some of it's closed. I really don't know. But
Local 100 raised a defense. Extreme provocation, the union says, resulted when the MTA insisted on allegedly illegal pension changes. But the local's position was undercut by its own international parent union, which was excused from the case after telling the judge it had not authorized the strike. In the end, late today, Justice Theodore Jones found the union had defied the court and the law.
That by reason of and in punishment for such criminal contempt, the defendant, Local 100, is hereby fined $1 million per day beginning today.
And that could be just the beginning, because tomorrow the judge is going to have another hearing and he could get union leaders in court, start fines against them. Then comes the city's lawsuit, in which it's seeking $25,000 a day against every single striking worker, 33,700 workers. So the point that was made here, according to the city's corporation counsel, the top legal aide to Mayor Bloomberg, was that the law does have teeth, will be enforced. The money is going to start to flow back out from the union, canceling potentially any gains that they may get from the strike, benefits perhaps at the negotiating table. And then finally, the union's attorney, Arthur Schwartz, saying just a few minutes ago, right out here on the plaza in front of the courthouse, that at $1 million a day, it threatens to wipe out the union's bank account in less than a week. So devastating blow. And that is the latest from the Supreme Court in Brooklyn. Tim Minton, News Channel 4.
Tim, let's just clarify with you, the legendary Mike Quill, the leader of TWU in 1966, actually went to jail for a few days. Can you talk a little bit more about any criminal charges or contempt with the union leadership?
It's possible under the law, having been found into contempt, that now leaders could be found in criminal contempt. But what people were saying here at the courthouse is that even if the judge were inclined to jail union leaders, and there is no indication that he is, he would be foolish to do it now, because then who's negotiating to try to end the strike? So the idea would be that even if he did send somebody to jail, it would be delayed until after the settlement was reached, and perhaps how fast the workers return to work would have some weigh on how long those people spend in jail. But again, that didn't come up today. The feeling by the state and the MTA is that the money is what will drive this settlement one way or the other, and they are hopeful it will drive the workers back to work.
But Tim, in the past, there have been fines imposed both in 1966 and in 1980, and at that time the strike continued in one case for 11 days and another case for 12 days. So, is there any indication that the union can survive these fines?
Well, there are two issues there, Linda. The first is that the fines were less back then. Even in today's dollars, the fines were less. In 1980, it was $500,000, much less than what's contemplated, even if you do the math and equate it now to dollars 25 years later, based on what's protracted here if this strike continues. But the second thing is that back then, the administrations in the city and the state were more willing to consider negotiating away the fines by giving bigger raises so that it's sort of offset. What both Mayor Bloomberg and Governor Pataki now have said quite clearly and emphatically, as recently as earlier today, is they're not going to do that. They're going to insist that the fines get paid, and they're not going to have offers be increased by the MTA to offset fines for an illegal strike. They say the illegal strike is outrageous, and the union and its members need to pay for it.
quick question, Tim, if we may. The issue of the international union and how that factors in, and whether or not that may be another obstacle that Roger Toussaint has to overcome.
Well, he's getting hit on another front now, and it was quite clear in court when the international's attorney went in and said that Roger Toussaint was explicitly told by the president of the international union, the parent union, you are making a mistake. You can get gains by continuing to negotiate. You take enormous risks by taking your members out on strike. That there is a rift between the brothers in the international, the brothers in the local, and that could end up having a backlash against Roger Toussaint from his own membership.
All right, Tim Minton, thank you very much.
And as Tim mentioned, the governor and the mayor, who are not taking a direct role in the negotiations this afternoon, Governor Pataki issued a plea to union leaders to resume contract negotiations. But Mayor Bloomberg thinks the TWU should not be invited back to the bargaining table until trains and buses start running again.
End the illegal strike. Come back to the table. The MTA is still there. They have been and are willing and will continue to negotiate in good faith.
The problem is not the negotiations for a contract. The problem is there is an illegal strike going on, and until the workers go back, I don't think anybody should be negotiating anything. You can't break the law and then use that.
The union is facing multi-million dollar fines for calling this strike. What could that mean for the union and for the rank-and-file transit workers? CBS2's Hazel Sanchez is live outside union headquarters with more on that. Hazel?
Well, Jim, the amount of potential fines against the TWU is skyrocketing and could potentially deplete the union's coffers. But the reality right now is that the union doesn't owe anything because they have filed an appeal in court.
What do we want? When do we want it?
Now. We don't want to die in a job. We want to have a decent life. We want to retire at a decent age.
Their demands are clear, but the price TWU members will pay to fight for them is still being decided in court. Some of the 33,000 striking transit workers rallied outside a Brooklyn court where yesterday a judge issued a $1 million fine against the union for the walkout. Today their lawyer filed an appeal, putting the fines on hold.
The penalties are frozen until an appeal is completed.
If an appeal is filed from a Taylor Law fine, which is what they were appealing, the fines are put in abeyance, stayed is what we call it, until the appeal is decided.
While that fine sits in limbo, the city has filed its own lawsuit against the union. They're suing the union for $1 million a day and seeking $25,000 a day against individual members, the fines doubling daily. A hefty prize for train and bus operators who make an average of $60,000 a year, which is still 10% more than the average private sector worker. Some frustrated New Yorkers say transit workers should pay.
I think they should all be fired. I wish Reagan was back. He'd fire every one of those son of a bitch.
And the appeals court judge is not expected to hear this particular case until next week. We are live outside TWU headquarters.
As the transit strike moves into its third day, major headaches and growing frustration for commuters continue.
I mean, this is ridiculous, okay? It's an illegal strike.
Late Wednesday, Union President Roger Toussaint hinted at a possible return to work with continued negotiations, but only if the MTA would relent on the issue of pensions. The union says the MTA's proposal that new employees pay 6% of their income for the first 10 years into their pensions instead of the 2% they pay now is unconscionable. The MTA has the mayor on its side.
The pension costs are costs that I have said this city cannot continue to bear.
The MTA is not alone. In the last year, 120 companies cut back or terminated pension or retirement plans. Huge employers like GM, Verizon, Motorola, and Hewlett-Packard.
Companies and the public sector is also following suit on this, are cutting back pensions to save money and save a bucket of money very quickly.
In New York City, week before Christmas, shoppers are outside trudging to work or trudging home, not in the stores or restaurants.
My feet are cold, my hands are cold, I just want to go home.
For so many, day three holds another very long, very cold walk home. Early Thursday morning, there was word key players from both sides, the MTA and the union, were back at the Grand Hyatt Hotel. That's where negotiations took place before the strike. There's been no word on whether negotiations are progressing. Gloria Riviera, ABC News.